Let's now look at harmony and voice leading. If our bass is unfigured, we need to decide which bass notes must have a chord and what kind of chord we should play. Only fundamental bass notes must have a chord. Passing notes and bass diminutions may be left without accompaniment. In stepwise passages, only the first bass note needs a chord, as we see in Staden's example. But one should always play a chord if the bass is leaping, as you can see in both examples by Agazzari and by Bianciardi. Chords may be consonant or dissonant. For now, I will only discuss consonant harmonies. Bianciardi shows us on which bass notes we should play 5-3 or 6-3 in both Cantus Durus and Cantus Mollis. We should play 5-3 on those bass notes not in need of a 6. A 6, for example, is needed to prevent a diminished fifth, but of course there are more reasons to use a 6 chord. The next step is to decide whether a 3rd or a 6 must be major or minor. For that, we need to know the contemporary rules of voice leading. The rule about a 6 says that a 6 must be played on sharpened bass notes, or on B in Cantus Durus and on E in Cantus Mollis. In all these cases to prevent a diminished fifth, and these 6 must be minor. Major 6 must be played on bass notes descending a step if that 6 is moving to an octave. In the treatises, the decisive rule concerning the use of accidentals is formulated as follows. One must proceed from an imperfect consonant to a perfect consonant by means of the nearest. This principle has been in force already since the beginning of the 15th century, but it is not always possible to apply this rule or be certain about its use. There are always exceptions or ambiguities, and then we have artistic choices made by the composers which may contraindicate the application of the rule. However, comparative analysis of treatises and compositions shows that the rule has been observed often enough to not be invalidated by the exceptions. Agazzari not only refers to this imperfect to perfect rule, but he also shows how it is applied in these two examples. One is in Cantus Mollis and the other in Cantus Durus. By showing the most used progressions, his examples reflect pretty much the basic harmonic material of the pre-tonal period. And although it was not his intention to show the application of the rule, but how to use figures, the rule is confirmed in almost every progression. To show you that the rule was indeed applied in composition, I could give you a great many examples. But here I can give only a few, showing major thirds and major six moving to an octave in contrary motion. Here is one by Radino. And here is one by Frescobaldi. He writes a major third on the first beat in bar 3. And I would play another major third on the second beat of that bar. These are typically the places where we will play minor thirds if we don't know the rules. Examples of major six moving to an octave can be found everywhere in Frescobaldi's works. Look at this characteristic progression in the last line of his Corrente Sesta. Turn to the beginning of our bass canzona and discuss its pre-tonal realization in more detail. On the first beat of the second bar, over an F, I suggest 5-3 instead of 6-3. As we saw already, the use of many 5-3 chords is a typical feature of early continuo realization and one of the essential differences with 18th century practices. It applies not only to bass notes set a fourth or a fifth apart, but often for leaps of a third as well, as we can see in this example of Frescobaldi's Canzone Terza a due canti. Even stepwise progressions may have successive fifths. Many composers in this period were not afraid to use such parallel fifths in keyboard music, as we see for example in Frescobaldi's Corrente del Balletto. They were not considered problematic as long as the upper part was still in contrary motion with the bass. One would expect it to be easy to find confirmation of this rule about the use of 5-3 chords in Frescobaldi's solo works for keyboard, but it is actually quite difficult to find straightforward chordal passages in these works because of the complexity of his compositional techniques. These include many types of dissonant motion as well as various chord breakings, even in his dances. Also, he often varies the number of parts, for example by omitting a fifth or a sixth, thus leaving it open which chord was intended. Another typical feature are the many passing notes, especially those over one bass note moving from a fifth to a sixth, or vice versa. We saw already examples in the treatises by Bianciardi and Agazzari. This compositional technique remained in use throughout the 17th century, and is even still described by Gasparini as a way to avoid parallel fifths in his L'Armonico Pratico. The example shown here is even taken from the 1764 edition. We can use passing notes between any third in a realization, as you can hear in the pretonal version. Another idiomatic element are the false relations, typically used by Frescobaldi in cadences. In bar 4 of my realization, I played such a false relation combined with passing notes. The great advantage of playing from an unfigured bass is that, to a certain extent, it allows us to choose for a particular voice leading, for example these false relations. We may in some cases even decide whether we play a major or minor third or sixth. On slow bass notes, if it fits the affect of the moment, it is sometimes possible to move over a single bass note from a minor to a major third, or vice versa. You can hear an example in my realization of Frescobaldi's Canzona detta l'ambiziosa in bar 5. This type of chromatic passing note will add much to the expressivity of the music. One could say that passing notes function as a bridge between harmony and melody. They are often used by composers to add elegance and fluency to chordal textures, also in written out accompaniments, such as by Castaldi or Kapsberger. Therefore, passing notes may be seen as a first step to elaborate a continuo realization, because they create melodic connections between chords. Which brings us to playing style.